kind attention, please. Good afternoon. Let's all take a moment just to settle. As we always do in Religions for Peace, let's begin with a minute of silence. Each pray, each meditate according to their own tradition from their own heart. So let's start. Thank you so much. We have been in our assembly concerned with welcoming the other. We now welcome one of our own dear beloved leaders who has helped Religions for Peace for so many years. Your All Holiness, the Ecumenical Patriarch, we welcome you here, and recall with great kindness, we recall your great kindness of the many ways over the many years that you have supported the Religions for Peace family. We're grateful deeply that you are here with us. Later in this concluding session, you will address us, but we wanted to welcome you and acknowledge your presence with us as we begin this afternoon. Just ever so briefly, I had the great privilege on our behalf to accompany the Ecumenical Patriarch as he arrived and was walking towards this room. And Your All Holiness, you recall that I immediately was recalling 1994 in Riva del Garda, when I was walking beside you, accompanying you as you were preparing to address the Sixth World Assembly of Religions for Peace. So we're grateful that you're here at the Ninth World Assembly. We have a wonderful session to conclude with. I'm going to first call the interreligious councils in Israel, from Kenya and from Thailand, and its youth network to kindly come join me here on the stage. So would you kindly come forward? As you're coming forward, I can share that there has been a call for innovative seed projects within the Religions for Peace family, youth members, not least, taking very innovative, very faith-filled efforts to advance the work of Religions for Peace. We've surveyed that work, and we're so pleased to be able to acknowledge in this assembly those three interreligious councils for remarkable, innovative work. So please step forward. Extraordinary friends and others still coming are helping to lead Religions for Peace. And we're very proud of the innovation that you are showing. We want to capture this for the whole movement. And we're honored indeed to award to you, on behalf of all of your brothers and sisters in Religions for Peace, these prizes, small seed grant prizes for innovative initiatives that you are taking. So let me just award them. There's something a little bit additional beyond the paper that I'm going to offer you. These are seeds that they are being given, seeds that will go into the ground. And so we will hear back from you as the plants sprout and grow, and we'll share that experience with the whole movement. So from all of us, we thank you and we congratulate you for your great work and for your creativity. Thank you. As we know, in addition to the plenary sessions that we've all enjoyed together, we've all participated in, we've had four commissions meeting. And the commissions, we do develop commission reports. These will be sent to everyone. But because all of the assembly cannot participate in a commission, we only receive the reports of the commissions, unlike the declaration that we will read shortly. So let me ask the chairperson of commissions 1, 2, 3, and 4 to kindly come to the stage so that a very brief report, a 5-minute report, can be offered on your commission. So please join and share with the assembly the deliberations of your commission. Dr. Lehnemann, you've come first, and so go to the podium, let your other colleagues come, go to the podium, and other colleagues come, stand with me. And we'll start with you, Dr. Lehnemann, please. We ask you to do this in about 5 minutes, if you can.
The fourth commission on welcoming the others for religious and multi-religious education is myself, my name is Johannes Lehnemann. I am professor for religious education in Germany, and I am the chair of the Peace Education Standing Commission. Welcoming the others for religious and multi-religious education. Final report. Insights. When tensions between religious and ethnic groups escalate to violence, the lack of knowledge and of a welcoming atmosphere combined with long-lasting prejudices leads some groups to become fanatics. Education can break down ignorance and prejudices, and in doing so, counter animosities and enmities between different cultural and religious groups. Session 1, analysis of problems. The concrete contextual conditions for religious and multi-religious education, for formal education, vary from country to country. I will not read that all, but we have different conditions in the different countries. Challenges identified by the CAISID project, the image of the other, for which we have had a global forum in advance of this conference. Recommendations by UNESCO and other educational bodies are only available in a limited number of languages and not sufficiently disseminated and evaluated. There's a great lack of research and impact studies. You find far too little networking for sustained dialogue between the multiple stakeholders in the field of intercultural and interreligious found. Session 2, interventions. We have found that welcoming the other, should draw on the spiritual, ethical, and social potential of religious communities. Religions are concerned with giving meaning to life, interpreting the world, and are not only focused on short-term goals, as sometimes governments are. Tasks for religious communities in this respect are first to vitalize their own principles of belief in an open way that opposes intolerance. At the same time, all religious and ethical education should be accompanied by a new approach to engagement that respects and appreciates people of other faiths as well as their values of life. Session 3, recommendations for multi-religious actions. First, initiating systematic and experiential approaches to cross-cultural and interreligious education. Second, encourage IRCs and broader RFP family members to cooperate with KAICID dialogue training workshops, which will begin in short. Third, participate in KAICID's global policy network on interreligious and intercultural education. Fourth, cooperating with institutions and promoters of intercultural education as UNESCO and the Alliance of Civilization. Fifth, develop an inventory of best strategies and programs in the field of interreligious education. Sixth, strengthening the work of the Peace Education Standing Commission through the exchange of interreligious peace education projects. And seventh, research measurable evaluation indicators for interreligious action. Activities on different levels of the RFP family, I have listed the possibilities on the global level, on the regional level, we have an example of Latin America. At the national level, the collaboration between religious communities, interreligious councils, and public education should help to improve curriculum development, teacher training, and educational programs. And at the local level, interreligious groups should be the initiators of meetings, dialogue, and cooperation between the religious communities. These activities also act as educational ways of welcoming the other. And then also mentioning the Women of Faith Network and the Youth Network. And at the end, the mission of the children from Kyoto, which is also relevant for the future. My religion is a way to peace. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Elias Al-Halabi. I am the Associate General Secretary for the Middle East Council of Churches. I belong to the Antiochian Orthodox Church, and I come from Lebanon. Welcoming the Other through Citizenship for Just and Harmonious Society was the title of Commission 2, and I had the privilege to facilitate the three sessions of this commission. In this commission, we had the opportunity to listen to distinguished keynote speakers and panelists from religious, secular, and civil society practitioners. The participants in this commission also had a very deep knowledge and wide expertise in the subject. It is indeed a very difficult task to summarize the richness of the discussions and the wide spectrum of ideas and experiences shared. Nevertheless, I will attempt to convey to your Honorable Assembly some affirmations and recommendations that resulted of the deliberations. Number one, citizenship is a fundamental right to every human being. Every stateless person should be granted citizenship in the places where they permanently live. The majority has to be self-critical and shall be responsible for the right of the minority, because the minority in one place is a majority in another place. The host community should be welcoming and empowering to the newcomers. There is a need to build trust between minority communities and the authorities. Every minority facing a problem should document their case and spread it to the whole world through Religions for Peace networks. Five, there is a need to strive for a compassionate justice and more just society where economic justice is an integral part. Six, the Commission calls upon Religions for Peace to establish an international commission for restorative and transitional justice. Seven, the Commission recommends that each interreligious council creates a chapter to work on religious minority rights in the region. Each religion should speak against extremism and should denounce hatred acts in their own communities. Eight, there is a need to explore theological responses to causes of anger projected on the other in different religions. Water, diseases, nuclear weapons, other issues are areas of interreligious cooperation. Women and youth should be actively engaged in order to make sure that words are transformed into deeds. 10, messages of togetherness drafted jointly between the Holy See and OIC should be appreciated. Finally, 11, the Commission recommends that there should be human rights, interfaith, and media training for religious representatives. Religions for Peace should establish working relationship with the media worldwide to propagate not only the news about crisis and catastrophes, but the positive experiences and good stories of coexistence. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, this is the report, summary report of Commission number 3, welcoming the other through human development and respect that respects the earth. My name is Francis Kuria from the Interreligious Council of Kenya. First, I would like to thank Rory Nash and Katrina Tino, the group rapporteurs, for taking the notes and helping us make this report. We also thank the moderators for the sessions, Catherine Taylor of USAID, Reverend Dr. Karen Hamilton, and His Excellency Dr. Kul Gautam, plus all the Commission panelists and attendees. The Commission identified with the problems as noted in the working paper on this Commission on pages 66 to 90 of the conference workbook. Additionally, they stressed the following key issues. One, the development progress, especially by governments in the South, on poverty reduction and human development indices is not matched by the reality on the ground. We have not seen a reduction by half in extreme poverty, not in the poorest countries, especially in Africa. Two, the world is adult-centered and this is likely to become more pronounced as the global population ages. We need to change this to become more child-centered. Additionally, that children are subject to increasing violence, including gender-based violence. Three, inequality is a key driver to underdevelopment. This inequality is between nations and also between gender. The rich nations consume more and pollute more, but the global effects of this excess consumption is felt by poorer nations. Four, current trends of consumption and pollution makes the earth as we live it unsustainable. Five, the profit motive and accumulation as a global credo has replaced morality and respect for human life and dignity, and is a bigger danger to addressing underdevelopment, inequality, and sustainable development that protects the earth. And lastly, in the additional issues, is that already we noted that we have passed the point of no return for climate change. We are deliberately living a world which will hurt our children. Political leaders have failed to reach a new deal on this issue. So what are the actions required
by religious leaders and which we put forward to this conference for adoption. This is a very small summary. We have a full report with all the recommendations, but since we have only 5 minutes, I'm just going to read them very short points. We noted the recommendations of the Working Commission paper on the conference backbook. Additionally, the Commission makes the following specific recommendations. One, religious leaders must organize and engage proactively in the post-2015 development agenda, bringing with them a stronger voice on moral issues in the discourse, building partnerships and coalitions that carries the poor, the vulnerable, and the marginalized. Two, we must build the capacity of religious leaders and religious institutions to expand their places of worship as centers of information, innovation, and learning for our next generation. These institutions need to be adequately resourced. Three, religious leaders and institutions need to robustly engage in policy dialogue that is informed by data and evidence that confronts current distortions and unmasks the true reality on the ground. Four, religious leaders must create a new mantra and movement, consume less, take from nature only what you need. For this conference has been urged to adopt a global program of Miss a Meal a Day, Invest in Our Sacred Water. Five, religious leaders must raise their moral voices on the global financial and economic system that breeds inequality, poverty, illiteracy, illnesses, and death. We must imbue a new morality into the profit motive by proactively engaging and persuading the owners of capital and the transnational corporations. And lastly, religious leaders must mobilize nationally, locally, regionally, and globally, and rally civil societies to push national governments to adopt a new climate change compact that will see significant reduction in greenhouse gas emissions and adequately ameliorates the great suffering of non-emitters. Thank you very much. That's the brief summary. More details are in the final report.
My name is Stein Willemstad. I'm the General Secretary of the European Council of Religious Leaders and facilitating the Commission number one, welcoming the other through conflict prevention and transformation. And this will just be some few glimpses from our report. In the two first sessions, we heard interventions, among others from the UN Mediation Support Unit and how it worked and some perspectives. We heard from the tragedy and the religious leaders' involvement in Bosnia-Herzegovina. We had an intervention about religious freedom and the tendency of religious freedom being restricted in more and more countries around the world. We heard a personal account of oppression in Iraq from one who was jailed there for 11 years. We also heard how religious communities through St. Egidio were involved in peace processes. And we heard accounts from Sierra Leone, Uganda, about involvement in conflicts of religious leaders, inter-religious cooperation. We heard about Buddhist resources for peace building in Thailand and an initiative in Syria, the Center of Peace for Children. The third session then came to some observations, and I will read 4 out of 12. Preventing conflict and resolving conflict is a proactive and preemptive endeavor. The duality of seeing the other as the other is itself a form of violence. Seeing the other in and as ourselves is true peace. Increasingly disillusioned young people need strong and positive role models to prevent them being radicalized and participating in violence and conflict. But religious leaders need to be both caring and prophetic in speaking out against violence and injustice.
conflict management and conflict transformation are different, and as a result, need to be treated differently. We need to fully understand the root causes of conflict before we can prevent or transform it. The term terrorist is increasingly used to justify the suppression of religious and social freedoms by authorities, even when acts of resistance are born out of injustice and repression. It is incumbent on religious leaders to critically reflect on whether the concept of terrorism is being used to mask unjust repression and respond accordingly. We came up with 7 recommendations, and I read 5. The religious leaders and communities should make proactive efforts to prevent the development of latent and structural conflict by reaching out and building relationships with the other at every opportunity. Religious leaders must communicate to politicians in clear and unequivocal terms that religion must not be co-opted to support violence and political gain. Religious leaders have a duty to set a positive example to their followers in the way they act and engage with and welcome the other. Religions for Peace should produce a resource which enables religious leaders and actors to be able to assess and identify which interventions are most appropriate and effective in different contexts and circumstances. And finally, Religions for Peace should explore ways of passing on its knowledge and skills in order to train additional skilled moderators and facilitators who are able to bring together diverse religious groups for the purpose of multi-faith collaboration and action. Thank you.
Commissions all working so hard, and the reports, and those who just gave the reports, we give you all large thanks. So these commission reports will be received. The declaration and these reports will become the materials for the strategic plan that will be written over the next 6 months and adopted by the International Executive Committee. So to all of the those in the commissions, heartfelt thanks for the great work. Mr. Marafi, the international trustee, is here to help me to present an award of recognition, a prize of appreciation to the Women of Faith, Religions for Peace, Women of Faith Network of Nigeria. So if they would please come forward. We are tremendously proud of the work that the Women of Faith in Nigeria are doing. So please come forward. All of you, if others of you wish to come forward, come forward. We celebrate all of the Women of Faith networks, but we are happy to bring our attention and our collective gratitude to you in Nigeria, you in the Women of Faith, Religions for Peace Network of Faith in Nigeria. You're dynamic, doing remarkable work, and we celebrate you today. We have among us some people that I would like to call forward. There won't be any speeches, but they deserve in the most special way our love, our support, our solidarity. So will the religious leaders from the peninsula, Korean peninsula, north and south, please come to the stage? So the religious leaders, north and south, please come to the stage. From the north and the south. We are so pleased to see all of you, each one of you, standing together here in our assembly, each of you a prized a member of the Religions for Peace family. And we salute you, and we are so committed to you.
First of all, I would like to express my deepest gratitude to the organizers and all participants of this wonderful assembly. We, Korean brothers and sisters from North and South, had a very meaningful dialogue over peace in the Korean Peninsula. We will continue to our best to bring peace to Korea, East Asia, and all over the world. We would like to humbly ask all of you as peace family to pray and to support for the peaceful reunification of Korea. Peace in Korea will surely contribute to peace of the world. Thank you very much. God bless you.
From North Korea, greeting peace with you.
세계 종교 평화 회의만이 정말 좋다는 감을 깊이 간직합니다.
This is his first attendance of a Religions for Peace, and a great deal of Religions for Peace, and very positive hope and prayer for the future.
왜냐하면 우리나라는 본의 아니게 분열되었지만은 종교 신앙은 분열되지 않았다는 것을 여기서 확인할 수 있기 때문입니다.
Even Korea divided by North and South, but in our religious communities and religious leaders, we are not divided. We formed unity and unification.
저희들은 앞으로 세계 종교 평화 회의 사명인 사랑과 평화 정의 마음을 안고 우리 민족끼리
CCRP와 함께 손잡고 자주 평화 통일을 위한 활동을 적극 벌리겠습니다. 여러분들이 이에 대해서 응당한 지지의 소원을 보내주시는 것을 믿어 부탁드립니다. 감사합니다.
We religious leaders from South and North will work hard to bring peaceful reunification of Korean Peninsula. We ask Religion Peace International family pray for us and support us in this endeavor. Thank you very much.
I'd like to now call Dr. Pachachi. Dr. Pachachi is part of the Diyanet, the Turkish Diyanet. So Dr. Pachachi, please join for just a few moments, please. We welcome you. We're so grateful to the Diyanet, to your president, Mehmet Ormez, who is a co-president of Religions for Peace. So welcome.
It is a privilege for me to be among these distinguished participants from all over the world, and I would like to express my appreciation to the Religions for Peace for their warm hospitality. I brought the warmest greetings of my president, Dr. Mehmet Görmez. Due to unavoidable circumstances, he is very sorry for not being able to join us today. Before starting my talk, I would like to extend condolences to the victims of Super Typhoon, which hit the Philippines during this time of pain and suffering. I'm sure we are all unified in sharing the pain of our sisters and brothers in the Philippines, and Presidency of Religious Affairs of Turkey has already started an aid campaign for those suffering the effects of typhoon. The growing confidence of the Religions for Peace, I believe, a concrete proof of the will of the community of nations to achieve cooperation and concord. We have assembled here in order to lay another brick on this singular initiative, i.e. Religions for Peace, the only goal of which is further connecting different cultures of faiths and bridging the gaps of understanding. Our aim is to do so by emphasizing and promoting the richness of diversity in our lives and fostering a universal atmosphere of mutual respect. In this regard, the city, Vienna, I think is very meaningful. As you will remember, last year, Austria celebrated the 100th anniversary of the legal recognition of Islam by law. This fact has provided that Austrian Muslims enjoy the same rights like other recognized religious communities in the country, while many democratic countries are hesitant to recognize the Muslim presence in their territories. The steady growth of Religions for Peace initiative is a source of happiness and optimism for all of us. This initiative has already demonstrated the international community's clear preference for cooperation and harmony rather than confrontation and conflict. Nevertheless, I'm confident when I say that there is still a lot to be accomplished and a long way to go. Many kinds of discriminations have a religious or an ethno-religious nature, or can be associated with this nature. Therefore, religious communities and institutions have particular responsibility in the prevention and even combating discrimination. They should urge governments to respect and promote the freedom of religion without prejudice and discrimination. Another aspect of the issue is that minorities, immigrants, followers of different faiths or newcomers should not be expected to leave their faith, culture, identity and values behind them. This should be our first principle, and we must accept them as they are and as they define themselves. It should be kept in mind that diversity is not a hindrance before a country but richness. The importance of language we use and attitudes we have towards others are important in this regard. At this point, I would like to underline the role of the media in both combating against the perpetuating the public misconceptions of minorities and Muslims in particular. In this context, freedom of expression is something misused or exploited to defame and distort the others rather than welcoming the others. Therefore, the delicate balance between the freedom of expression and the respect for religious sentiments should be well respected. While I conclude, I would like to share my strong conviction that our work here will definitely help bring a more peaceful future, and I extend to you all my heartfelt thanks for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pachacci. We have brief remarks. Everybody is doing their best to keep themselves brief. We have Ambassador Rashad Hussein. Ambassador Rashad Hussein, please join us here for brief remarks. We welcome you. We are so delighted that you could join us. Ambassador Rashad Hussein is the President Obama's ambassador to the Organization of Islamic Conference. So we welcome you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Vindley. It's a really humbling and inspiring and really an honor to be a part of such an honorable gathering. I want to express my gratitude to Religions for Peace for your partnership, and to Dr. Vindley specifically, and to the Kasid Center for all the good work that you've been doing. We're really excited to be working with you as well and to partner with you going forward. My role as the Special Envoy to the OIC has been to deepen and expand our partnerships with Muslim communities around the world. And in doing so, we've been working with a multilateral organization such as Organization for Islamic Cooperation and the UN, and we work with governments directly. But a really important part of what we've been doing is expanding our partnerships with civil society. And it's been very clear to me and to us in this role that we cannot do so effectively. We can't fully achieve our objectives of advancing peace and security around the world without working effectively with religious leaders such as yourself. And it's been very clear as well in our travel around the world that the religious leaders and the people in this room are oftentimes more influential than anyone else in your communities and in your countries, even more so than the political leaders. And we've seen firsthand the powerful impacts that we can have as a part of our partnership on a number of issues. And so when we engage with religious leaders, we don't do so just for the sake of engagement or to sit and have a dialogue, but really to advance core interests that we have and interests that we share with our partners around the world. In the area of health, for example, we've been working with religious leaders on the eradication of polio, which is a disease that's endemic in three Muslim-majority countries. We've been working with religious leaders on advancing maternal and child health, and we've had partnerships and pilot programs in a couple of countries on that project as well. We've been working to advance human rights, which we believe we can't do effectively without religious leaders. Specifically, We have a program that we've been working on in partnership with the Islamic Society of North America, Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayah and others, Sheikh Al-Azhar in Egypt, we visited on this project, to advance the rights of religious minorities and people of all faiths around the world, and specifically in Muslim-majority countries. We've seen that while we can raise these issues at the government level, and to make clear that it's important that the rights of all people, of all faiths, are respected, that when the declaration or the articulation of principles and protocols comes indigenously from within the Muslim community, when we're dealing with Muslim-majority countries, that can have a more persuasive impact and can add a data point about what Islam actually says as a religion regarding the protection of people of other faiths, which is oftentimes not implemented and oftentimes misunderstood by communities at large. In the area of countering violent extremism, religious leaders have been at the forefront, making clear that terrorism is not based in any religion. And particularly the Islamic leaders that we have been dealing with have worked very hard in coming up with fatwa and declarations on this topic. And we've engaged with religious leaders in a number of places, including in Afghanistan, in Yemen, in Egypt, in Nigeria, and so many other countries around the world. And we know that the long-term solution to many of the problems that we face is in education, and that's secular education and religious education. In order to make sure that young people are not taken advantage of by those that are looking to advance their own agenda, we have to make sure that young people, first and foremost, have the ability to read and access to basic education. In order to make sure that those that would argue that within Islam there are teachings that would justify killing of innocent people in the name of religion, in order to make sure that we root out completely that concept, religious leaders are going to have to play the most persuasive and impactful role. And many of you in this room have played an integral role in doing that, but not just on the issue of violent extremism, but on many of the issues that we face, many of the areas of mutual interest that we have. Ignorance is really at the heart of the problem. When it comes to people saying that, for example, there's a Western campaign or some religious argument against a polio vaccine or good access to maternal and child health, we know that there is a role for religious leaders to play in addressing all those issues. So we'll continue to keep working with you. We look forward to partnering with you. We look forward to our continuing partnership with Religions for Peace and the Casey Center, and I extend the greetings of President Obama and Secretary Kerry as we go forward, and congratulations on a very successful assembly. Thank you so much.
And finally, we have very courageous colleagues here. We all recall the devastating hurricane in Haiti. And so I would like to ask the representatives from Religions for Peace Haiti, who have been working just tirelessly together, come to the stage. It has to be brief, but we are so with you in spirit and so proud of you in the work that you have done. Yeah.
Soy el obispo Julio Holguín de la Iglesia Anglicana en la República Dominicana. Lo que nos mueve aquí en este momento es compartir con ustedes y pedirle apoyo para una resolución debido a una injusticia que se ha cometido. Hay una mujer dominicana, todo comienza con una mujer dominicana que solicita al Tribunal Constitucional un recurso de amparo porque le estaban rechazando su nacionalidad dominicana. El Tribunal Constitucional, el 23 de septiembre, evacuó una sentencia mediante la cual desnacionaliza a todos los descendientes de inmigrantes que llegaron a la República Dominicana desde el año 1929, es decir, afectando a cuatro generaciones por lo menos, por el hecho de que sus parientes, antepasados, no ingresaron con documentos legales. De manera que invito a mi colega, República Dominicana y Haití comparten la misma isla y por lo tanto nos duele que se haya cometido este acto de injusticia por medio de un tribunal constitucional.
Antes de todo, quisiera agradecer a mi colega de la República Dominicana. Somos una isla, dos países. Nos queremos mucho, somos hermanos y quisiéramos ir adelante haciendo esta integración fraternal, respetando cada uno al otro. Now, I will need your support because my colleague Bishop Olguin and myself, we are before you, we stand before you to ask you for approval. Religions for Peace, we, religious leaders, participating at the 9th World Assembly of Religions for Peace in Vienna on November 22nd, 2012, with the team, welcoming the order, respectfully submit this petition to the honorable members of the Constitutional Court of the Dominican Republic in order to request the immediate annulment of the decision 168-12, which affects more than 200,000 Dominican citizens born from immigrant parents since 1929. This decision is contrary to the Constitution of the Dominican Republic, as well as to the American Convention on Human Rights. It is also contrary to the fundamental principles, values, and teachings shared by all religious traditions participating in the Religion for Peace 9th World Assembly, which gathers over 600 religious leaders from worldwide. We call upon the faith communities of the Dominican Republic to respect and to put in practice the multi-religious mandate, which is to welcome the other and to promote the dignity of all human beings because we are all members of one family created by the divine. Vienna, Austria, November 22nd, 2012. If you are okay, clap your hands. Thank you, thank you.
We receive your call with gratitude, and we will carry it then out of this assembly into our next meeting of World Council and so forth. So, dear esteemed delegates, it's time now for the sharing of the work that each one of you contributed so vitally to, which is the reading of the declaration which you have produced as the Ninth Assembly of Religions for Peace. Just before this declaration is read, I would like to say before all of us as delegates, and of course before the wider world, that we received the great work of CAISED and brought this into our own assemblies, deliberations, and so we are profoundly grateful to CAISED, not only for your hosting, but for the great contribution of quality reflection into the very content of our own assembly declaration. So we thank you.
more than 600 religious leaders and people of faith, representing all historic faith traditions in every region of the world, have convened in Vienna, Austria, as the 9th World Assembly of Religions for Peace. We have come from the global Religions for Peace family of 90 national interreligious councils and groups, 5 regional councils, 1 world council, and international networks of religious women and religious youth. Our respective religious traditions have called us to work together for peace. Previous world assemblies of religions for peace have discerned positive elements of peace, common threats to peace, and a multi-religious consensus expressed through shared values for peace. We commit to common action based upon these deeply held and widely shared values as a foundation for affirming the imperative of welcoming the other as the heart of our multi-religious vision of peace.
We reaffirm the positive elements of peace shared by our respective religious traditions. Peace is central of our respective religions, and our diverse faiths compel us to work together to build it. Love, compassion, and honesty are stronger than hate, indifference, and deceit. All men and women endowed with human dignity share common humanity, must care for one another, and are called to consider the problem faced by the others their own. We accept the call to stand on the side of and raise up the most vulnerable and to promote just and harmonious society. We value women and men as equal partners of efforts to build peace. Children are paramount concern. The special state of childhood deserves our protection and care, and should receive priority from our society resources. Nonviolent conflict transformation through dialogue reconciliation are central to peacemaking. The use of nuclear weapons and weapons of mass and indiscriminate destruction is immoral, and advancing human development and protecting the earth are part of the strengthening for peace.
The positive elements of peace we share are inextricably linked to our shared calling to confront common threats to peace. These threats include the misuse of religion in support of all manner of violence, including violent extremism. An ongoing spiritual crisis that erodes values that support life. Violent conflict and the proliferation of arms. Extreme and growing inequality, including widespread violation of basic rights. Violence against women, abuse of children, and weakening support for families. Extreme poverty, preventable diseases left untreated, and broad-scale lack of opportunity. And finally, environmental degradation, natural resource depletion, and climate change, all of which threaten civic order human flesh. While we confess that some religious believers betray the peace teachings of their faith, we continue to commit ourselves and our communities to a culture of peace that advances shared well-being grounded in common healing, common living, and shared security.
Rising hostility. The Ninth World Assembly of Religion for Peace called attention to the new threat to the peace, rising hostility. We are deeply tolerated by this rising hostility in society and within and among religious communities. This hostility towards the other is an extension of intolerance and too often takes the form of violence. Victims of hostilities are often vulnerable and population, including members of ethnic, religious, and linguistic minorities, migrants, refugees, asylum seekers, internally displaced, and stateless persons. Hostilities arise from all sectors of society, government, individual organizations, and social groups. Although freedom of religion or belief is increasingly valued internationally, a growing number of governments are placing restrictions on religious beliefs and practices. Often some religions are placed in an inferior status in relation to the others. Sectarian and communal violence is dividing societies, fueling conflict, destroying innocent lives. Social hostility towards individuals and groups fueled by intolerance and fear of the other threaten unity, dignity, good government, good governance, and shared well-being. More and more people are persecuted because of their faith. Intolerance and violence in all manifestations are obstacle to peace. They seriously exacerbate other grave threats to peace. Religious communities must confront hostility towards the other, and as both are an agent threat and also a key tracking other critical threats to peace.
Welcoming the other, a multi-religious vision of peace. Our multi-religious vision of peace includes the call to all people of faith to welcome the other. Each of our diverse faith traditions calls for profound active solidarity with and empathy for the other, rooted in a spirit of unity as deeply held and widely shared value among our religious communities. Welcoming the other means respect and acceptance of one another. We support the robust promotion of tolerance, a principle that is fostered by recognizing universal human rights and is essential for welcoming the other. Welcoming the other both strengthens and goes beyond tolerance by calling each religious community to stand in solidarity with the dignity, vulnerability, and well-being of the other. With the full force of its respective spiritual and moral teachings, such teachings are specific to each religious tradition. They include striving for justice, accepting self-sacrifice for the well-being of the others, bearing innocent suffering, returning good for evil, seeking and extending forgiveness, and expressing unrestricted compassion and love. Welcoming the other calls us to work to advance the full flourishing of human dignity through the holistic development of human beings.
Building on previous assembly declarations, we recognize that welcoming the other invites every person into the co-building, co-nurturing, and co-stewarding of our shared well-being, which includes respecting nature and developing in harmony with it. Stewardship of the earth is a sole religious obligation. Religious communities working together can be powerful actors to prevent violence before it erupts, diffuse conflicts when it occurs, and lead their communities to rebuild war-torn societies. Excessive resources devoted to arms are better spent to alleviate poverty, advance education, and basic healthcare for all, and address environmental challenges. Welcoming the other involves seeing ourselves in each other. To facilitate this, we must teach nonviolence, conflict prevention strategies, and the universal value of peace to our children. Our shared positive vision of peace grounds for us a human right to peace. We can welcome the other by advancing a more robust notion of citizenship that acknowledges basic human rights, including freedom of religion or belief.
Religious communities welcome the other when they work together to advance human development that respects the earth. Welcoming the other rejects complicity in the destruction of the earth, which aggravates disasters and human distress. The preservation of our air, soil, and water is essential for human survival and well-being. Development should honor the continuity of life, preserving nature for the benefit of present and future generations. Our respective religious communities can become centers of religious education on welcoming the other. To do this, we must reclaim our own religious teaching that calls us to welcome the other, widely share them among our respective faith communities, including our young people, and put them into practice. Religious communities can work to reverse the rising tide of hostility toward the others by advancing a multi-religious vision of peace and through multi-religious action, specifically the Religions for Peace World Assembly calls on
religious leaders and people of faith to honor and protect human dignity whenever and wherever it is under attack, to foster more active collaboration between women and men in exalting the dignity of women and girls, and to work together to prevent violence against them, to speak out on behalf of vulnerable individuals and groups, and all people persecuted or whose existence is denied because of their faith. To recognize that the well-being of immediate and extended families, as well as of communities, are a prerequisite to the well-being of children. To address issues of responsibility and accountability for the causes of climate change. To acknowledge the value of youth-led grassroots initiatives aimed at welcoming others and promoting sustainable peace. To advance spiritual values essential to shared well-being. To reinforce acceptance of diversity in our communities. To welcome the other through prayer and service. to engage in multi-stakeholder partnerships to welcome the other, and to leverage the power of multi-religious networks to welcome the other by advancing human dignity, shared well-being, and citizenship through concrete multi-religious action.
Governments, international organizations, and civil society to promote transparent governance that ensures and protects the development of comprehensive well-being and full enjoyment of universal human rights for all. Provide legal remedies for victims of intolerance. Promote social policies and legal norms that recognize the dignity of migrants, refugees, asylum seekers, internally displaced, and stateless persons. Advance citizenship that ensures human dignity while protecting the safety and well-being of all individuals, including freedom of religion or belief, and other rights of individuals and groups, whether in the majority or in the minority. Ensure the protection of places of worship. Eliminate nuclear and other weapons of mass destruction, and stem the proliferation of small arms. Promote restorative justice to heal both the victims and the perpetrators of violent conflict. Address threats of nuclear exposure and contamination to protect all living things and future generations. And support and partner with people of faith, religious leaders, religious communities, and religious networks in their efforts to welcome the other.
All people of goodwill to call attention to and work to eliminate all forms of intolerance and discrimination by states, by non-state actors, by civil society, by religious groups and leaders, and by individuals. Welcome the other. We, the delegates of the 9th World Assembly of Religions for Peace, are united in our commitment to resist threats to peace that take the form of hostility toward the other, and to take positive action to welcome the other by promoting the true flourishing of all human beings. These given commitments and corresponding calls to action express our multi-religious vision of peace. Vienna, Austria, 22nd November 2013.
As they gather, we can simply give a word of appreciation for the tremendous work of all the persons in the assembly to produce this declaration. As one who has read all of the assembly declarations numerous times, this declaration both honors our origins, the steady development across the different assemblies, and yet adds, indeed further unfolds, the very shared vision of peace that we are discerning here together in Religions for Peace. Shivan Mukhaji. My dear brother, Fasun Gamha, please. Yes, please, Venerable, please come. Brothers and sisters, fellow delegates, partners, we are approaching the time to recognize that our assembly is concluding. We are already beginning to look forward. Sheikh Shaban Mubaje, the head of the Supreme Islamic Council of Uganda, the co-president of the African Council of Religious Leaders, Religious for Peace, and recently elected international co-president, we turn to you first to offer us your remarks, your reflections as we prepare to go forward.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of the Almighty God, most gracious, most merciful. Your Excellencies, Graces, and Eminences, esteemed religious leaders in your various capacities, the delegates of the 9th World Assembly of Religions for Peace, our development partners, Assalamu alaikum. I greet you in the name of Allah, the Almighty. The peace be upon you all. It gives me great pleasure to address you at the conclusion of this very important congregation of eminent religious leaders, women and youth, gathered here for the last 3 days, reflecting on crucial issues affecting humanity today, under the theme of welcoming the other. Permit me sincerely to thank the organizers of this 9th World Assembly, Religions for Peace International, under the able leadership of our brother and a friend, Dr. William Bentley, the Secretary General. Thank you very much for organizing this successful assembly, Brother William Bentley and your staff. In the same vein, join me in thanking our co-sponsor and partner, the King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue, KICIT, under the leadership of His Excellency Faisal bin Abdulrahman bin Muhammad, the Secretary General. Thank you very much. I wish to take this opportunity to applaud the assembly facilitators, contributors, and the presenters for a job well done. And for the delegates, I thank you for your keenness and active participation over the last 3 days. This exhibited your resolve to individually and collectively make the world a better place for all humanity, and for this I sincerely thank you. Esteemed colleagues, our assembly theme, welcoming the other, could not have been more appropriate and timely than now, when the world is experiencing wide-scale conflict, both armed and social, domestic as well as gender-based violence, sectarian violence, widening gap between the rich and poor, threats of climate change, and a global warming exhibited by the many natural disasters and increasing individualism, among other threats. Many papers presented at this assembly have highlighted the urgent need to strengthen our faith-based agency as a platform for unity and dialogue. This assembly has helped us to further deepen our understanding of the need for joint and collaborative action in addressing common challenges that confront us both in our work and daily lives. Islam teaches us أحب لأخيك ما تحب لنفسك, meaning wish for others that wish for yourselves. Welcoming the other calls upon us to identify and understand the other. It is therefore essential that we intensify our efforts towards self-awareness and education for the future generation. Once we achieve this, we can then use this knowledge and understanding to address the common challenges that confront us, particularly working to transform conflicts and build peace, a just and harmonious society, human development that respects the earth and religious and multi-religious education. As we come to the end of the 9th Assembly here in Vienna, my appeal to all of us is to be able to translate our recommendations into actionable programs and activities that will in turn lead to social transformation of our societies and more forward our agenda of welcoming the other. Before I conclude, I wish to share with you our experience in Uganda. As Uganda celebrated the 50 years of independence last year, 2012, religious leaders agreed together on a shared vision and the values of the Uganda we want in the next 50 years. Under this framework, religious leaders committed themselves to work to ensure that this country strives to attain a God-fearing nation, a healthy nation, a secure and stable nation, a prosperous nation, a harmonious nation, and lastly, a caring nation. Religious leaders also agreed on a mutual accountability framework, and this would go a long way in ensuring that we hold each other accountable on their commitments and the values we pledged to pursue together. Dear friends, learning from the Ugandan experience, I wish to call upon all of us to be committed to the resolutions and recommendations of this assembly and hold each other accountable. In our pursuit to welcome the other, we need to bear in mind that the religious fraternity cannot achieve this without building strong partnerships and networks with government, cultural institutions, development partners, and the civil society. These leaders have to be deliberately engaged to embrace our theme of welcoming the other. Ladies and gentlemen, one other pertinent issue that has come to the fore during the celebration, the deliberations, is the need for multi-religious education for our children. It is therefore important for us to influence policies which result in formulation and design of curricula that facilitate multi-religious education. This will go a long way to inculcate values of love, sharing, respect for one another, thus laying a strong foundation for actualizing our theme, welcoming the other now and the years to come. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, I wish to take this opportunity to congratulate all of you upon the successful completion of this nice World Assembly of Religions of Peace International. Thank you for listening, and may God bless you.
Sheikh Shabab Mbaji, we thank you very much for your remarks. Now, Dharma Master, Most Venerable Sitagu Sayadaw, please, we invite you to offer your reflections as we go forward.
Most of them, benevolent, distinguished delegates, my dear brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, I am Dr. Yanisha, Chancellor of International Buddhist Academy from Myanmar. It is a great honor and privilege for me to be here at this August Great Assembly. I am particularly grateful to all collaborators for their relentless effort in organizing this grand and great gathering. I am feeling now I am in the great family. This great gathering gave us the opportunity of a meeting like-minded people who are working together toward a common ground of peace, harmony, happy coexistence for all of mankind. Today, we are living in the world of diversity and culture and faith. Political system, economic system. In this world, different people may have different opinions on different problems. Yet, their problems are common to all. We are interested in finding a solution to them. There will be no final solution to our human problems. Therefore, we must accept unity and diversity concept and find a common platform for solving the common problems of the peace, of such peace and security. Despite such a diversity, I am confident that by finding bridges of culture and religion, we can have better understanding of other religions, and we can reduce the tension, and we can avoid the conflict. I support the view that a bridge is a crossing in both the directions which allow people to meet together and work together for common goal. I also agree with the view that diversity is a blessing that mankind should and must embrace and celebrate. By building such bridges, we will be able to channel different views and inspiration into common ground to promote the peace. We must believe in our rationality and common sense that only alternated the war and conflict is to peace, security, and coexistence. We should try to conquer ourselves by replacing hatred, anger, greed, ignorance, prejudice by loving kindness, compassion, tolerance, forgiveness. At the same time, we must oppose extremism and aggressiveness, any manifestation around this world. But we should be mindful that if we are unable to reduce and remove evil thought, evil speech, evil deed, we are like the beings living in a world of darkness. When there is a darkness, the light is of a bitter necessity. The darkness and the light are the two opposite things. They cannot coexist. We have to put the light in the place of darkness. When there is a fire, the water is an urgent need for us. Today, the whole world is under the darkness of a sorrow, under the darkness of a suffering caused by violence, conflict, and brutal fighting. In the Buddha's message, it was said, the world, the whole world is totally blind. The world is unstable. The whole world is burning internally and externally. The whole world has witnessed a lot of bloodshed due to the power craving, ignorance of the truth. So, the world is badly in need of a peace, a harmony, and coexistence. This is a great challenge for the political leader, for the spiritual leader, for religious leaders. We all have to accept those responsibilities and embrace us for those challenges. Your Holiness, Most Reverend, ladies and gentlemen, every religion has an outer shell and inner core. Outer shell consists of rites, ritual, ceremony, belief, mind, and doctrine. These differentiate one religion from another. However, there is an inner core of all religion, which is common to all religion. This is the universal teaching of morality, charity, discipline, pure mind, pure love, compassion, goodwill, tolerance, insight, and truth. This is a common denominator that all religious leaders ought to emphasize to teach their followers to practice. If the proper importance is attached to the essence of religion, love, tolerance, compassion are shown for their sufficient level, conflict and violence be minimized. Most benevolent, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, all human beings should be free to profess and free to follow their faith. However, they must be careful not to neglect to practice the essence of their own respective religion, not to disturb others by their own religion, not condemn other faith. In this diversity of the faith, when people of a different view approach the Buddha, said, Let us set aside our differences. Let us give attention to what we can agree on. Let us to come on code which we agree upon into practice. Why quarrel? Such wise counsel still retain its value until the duty. It is clear that both treat of the violence primarily hurt their own kith and kin. They may do not directly through their intolerance or indirectly by provoking the violence to respond to their action. On the other hand, blessed are merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. This is the law of nature. It may equally be called the degree of the call. The Buddha said, animosity can be eradicated by its opposite, which is love, patience, forgiveness, and so on. Animosity cannot be eradicated by animosity. Violence is seized by non-violence. Violence never sees through violence. Hatred never sees through the hatred. Through pure love only, they see. My dear brothers and sisters, most venerable, this is an eternal law, ancient law. This is a Dhamma. Why is it called a Dhamma in the world? Has nothing to do with the Buddhists and the Hindus and Jainists and Judaism and Sikhism and Islamists and any other is. Dhamma is simply truth. There is nothing new to teach in this world, but only the truth. I believe all of our religious leaders are searching for a technique how to solve the problems of human life. As long as we cannot find out the truth within ourselves, we cannot solve any problems of life. Truth is our common ground or common platform. Dhamma teaches us that before we harm us, we must harm ourselves by generating mental negativity and removing such negativity. We can find peace within ourselves, strengthen it in the world outside. May the truth prevail in its present purity in this world.
Dharma Master, Most Venerable Sifu, I thank you very much for your words. Your Holiness, the Ecumenical Patriarch, may we call on you, please, to address us. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. Your Beatitude, the Archbishop of Albania, Your Eminences, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. On the occasion of the 9th World Assembly facilitated by Religions for Peace, we bring you greetings of love and peace from the Ecumenical Patriarchate, the first see of the Orthodox Church. We are honored to be with you in Vienna, and we give thanks to God for the opportunity to address this esteemed assembly. We extend a sincere thanks to Dr. William Bentley, Secretary General, and the Planning Committee for inviting us to share our thoughts about working together for human dignity and peace. Before us, we have an example of peace in the making. Religions for Peace and the King Abdallah International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue, KAISID, have already demonstrated the ability to mobilize and collaborate to to make this week of meetings a reality. This inspires us to recall the wisdom of an ancient soul. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brothers and sisters to dwell together in unity. The ultimate goal of this assembly is to create a new paradigm to embrace the essence of peace and unity, which exists in all of humanity. Indeed, how good and pleasant that day will be when we experience such fellowship, where everyone will be free to worship God in their own way. Let us leave this place today and walk the path toward that peace. Last November, we took a step along that path when we were gathered in this very city, in Vienna, for the inauguration of the King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue. Looking back today, there have been many accomplishments on our journey toward peace since that gathering. Furthermore, just a few weeks after our address in Vienna last year, we released from the Ecumenical Patriarchate an encyclical calling for 2013 to be the year of global solidarity. The need to do so was increasingly clear. I quote, "We discriminate against one another by means of fanaticism with regard to religious and political convictions, by means of greed in the acquisition of material goods, and through expansionism in the exercise of political power. These are the reasons why we come into conflict with one another. We are not the first generation of humanity to face such challenges. In 313 of the Christian era, Emperors Constantine and Licinius met face to face for a dialogue on the injustice of persecuting minority religions. Three centuries of murder and discrimination had become detrimental to all peoples living in those societies. As a result, the Edict of Milan was signed into law, granting freedom of religion to all members of their respective communities. The document itself tells us the story behind its creation. For the sake of peace in our times, that each one may have the free opportunity to worship as one pleases, this regulation is made that we may not seem to detract from the dignity of any religion. For the sake of peace in our times, we too call for the free opportunity to worship as one pleases. This fundamental human right is the cornerstone for building solidarity between peoples and nations. It is the most essential element for building peace. We must allow individuals to worship God freely and without reprisal. We cannot pretend that we respect the dignity of another human being if we do not allow them to worship God peacefully. 17 centuries have come and gone since the Edict of Milan was enacted. Yet, unfortunately, the world remains vulnerable to the same temptation of denying others their basic human right of freedom of worship. In recent months, the intensity and frequency of persecution against minority faiths has increased in virtually every corner of the planet. Certainly, demands for tolerance from all religious leaders and peoples are needed. However, something more remains, namely loving our neighbor. Merely tolerating one another only further emphasizes the pervasive goal of dominance. If one must tolerate the other, the one tolerated is viewed as less valuable than the one who tolerates. This is a great deception and danger. We believe that religious leaders must move beyond mere tolerance to love. When we embrace and welcome the other with genuine concern and love, as if the other is our very own neighbor and our very self, then we have the foundation for creating lasting peace in the world. To love another is to welcome them into your life and home. To love another is to prevent their harm through discrimination and contempt. It is to end aggression and war. When our enemy becomes important and invaluable to us, when our enemy is regarded as a reflection of ourselves, we no longer face an enemy, but a neighbor, a friend, an ally. When neighbors join together to seek the benefit of the other, we begin to live in solidarity with all humanity. Daily news reports would lead us to believe we have nothing but enemies. However, there are glimmers of hope that have emerged this year. In spite of the great difficulties that have been presented, for example, this year, the King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue has begun a process of examining the image of the other through regional workshops. These workshops have explored shared values and best practices for educating people about dialogue and peace. This flagship program will be continued in the coming years. Moreover, this past March, an outstanding effort towards protecting vulnerable children in Uganda was undertaken through a strategic partnership between CAICID and Religions for Peace. This effort is literally saving the lives of Uganda's children through basic nutrition and health education. We are all sharing in the well-being of Uganda when we care for her children. In April of this year, Religions for Peace convened a meeting of diverse Syrian religious leaders who established a Religions for Peace Council in Syria. This was a courageous step initiated in a place where peace is so grievously threatened. In September, His Holiness Pope Francis called a peace vigil for the nation of Syria to call attention to the strife and bloodshed there. He reminded the nations, war always marks the failure of peace. It is always a defeat for humanity. And today, brothers and sisters, we are gathered here together again in this city. We are shoulder to shoulder, standing for those things we believe in and calling for a new way of loving our neighbor. As we closed our encyclical last December, declaring 2013 as the year of global solidarity, let us encourage one another during this year of global solidarity to make every conscious effort as individuals and nations for the reduction of the inhumane consequences created by the vast inequalities, as well as the recognition by all people of the rights of the weakest among us, so that everyone may enjoy the essential goods necessary for human life. Thus, we shall indeed witness, at least to the degree that it is humanly possible, the realization of peace and goodwill on earth. Therefore, thanks be to God, who created humanity with the capacity to live in peace. May we all find this peace in our hearts and share it with the world. We must not cease and cannot be defeated in our efforts to secure human dignity and advocate the well-being of all our neighbors in the world. God bless you all. And when we leave this beautiful city of Vienna, let us go in peace, and until our next World Assembly, World Conference, let us remain in God's love, in solidarity. Thank you.
We thank you for being with us, and we thank you for the words that you have shared with us. Esteemed delegates, partners, it's now a particular joy for me and for all of us, but allow me to call my great friend and my partner, Dr. Faisal Muammar, Secretary General of CAICID, to please share his reflections with us.
Ladies and gentlemen, religious leaders, assalamu alaikum. Peace be upon all of you. I would like to say some words out of the formal speeches we usually do. It's really my honor to speak in front of you when we are in the closing session. But before we say anything, I would like you to send best wishes to one of our staff who really did a lot of things to organize this event. Unfortunately, yesterday she felt not good, and she was taken to the hospital, Dr. Al-Masih, wishing her the best of health. And I would like to congratulate my brother, Dr. William Kendry, and Religions for Peace for helping us to bring you to this beautiful city of Vienna. We never thought that an organization like Religions for Peace, which is now reaching the maturity stage now, 43 years old, I try to calculate your age, joining hand with CAICID, which is almost less than 1 year old, to serve peace and to serve humanity through dialogue. So we would like to thank you all for what you did to us, and for coming to Vienna and sharing with us these beautiful 4 days or 2 days of your time and the result you reach today. Second, and that's my personal opinion, in the last few years, there were deadly mistakes happening around the world because of misunderstanding. So what you do in this noble gathering, And what we do in CAISID and other international organizations, we are trying, we're doing our best to prevent this deadly misunderstanding. We are going to knock all the doors, searching for peace, searching for coexistence, searching for love, and establishing the peace to the whole humanity. We have chosen the image of the others. And when we had the discussion with our friends at the Religions for Peace organization, we decided that we do something. We join hand by talking about the theoretical issues, and then we try to implement it through the members of Religions for Peace. And this is the promise we had from our friends at the Religions for Peace, and I can see that in their recommendation today that they are meeting our demand with them, and thank you for very much for what you had done in this final, in the final of this event. Second is, we think that we are building soldiers for dialogue, and this is very important. We can see that 90 councils around the world are connected to each other, and they know what to do. So if each one of you tries to knock the door of the decision makers and to help us implement what we do, we can do it through dialogue. So welcoming the others is really bringing a lot of suggestions and recommendations, and we are honored to hear it today. And we can promise you that we are going to put our hand with the Religions for Peace to help them if they need our help to implement what you reached in this assembly. We are looking forward to continue this cooperation, and I would like to, on behalf of our board and on behalf of our Council of Party, to thank all of you and to thank all of the religious leaders who spoke about us. And we are listening to your wisdom and to your beautiful word we heard today about CAISID. We deeply thank you, and we thank everybody who helped us, and I would like to thank the staff of Religions for Peace and our staff in CAISID, and whoever helped us from the media and from the people of Vienna and this beautiful city of Vienna, and also this hotel, which is really the management of this hotel, is trying to do their best to make this event succeed. So God bless you all. See you next time. Thank you very much.
Sheikh Yuban Mubaje and Dharma Master Most Venerable Sitagu, and Your All Holiness, the Ecumenical Patriarch. First of all of us here are so grateful for the words that you have shared with us as you point us out from this assembly to this assembly, which is 3 days, 352 other days are action for us in terms of working on the ground. So you have pointed us with mercy, with loving kindness, with love, with peace, all in the right direction. Dear esteemed Secretary General Faisal Muammar, you have done something truly extraordinary. You have not only labored to bring CAISID into being. When I was privileged to be in the opening session of CAISID with you a few days ago, I spoke to the wonderful people that had gathered, and I reflected that there wasn't a person in the room who couldn't not only appreciate the great goodness that was being advanced by CAICID, but could also appreciate the enormous care and attention and kindness and solicitude and the practical labor of bringing together the CAICID gathering. I then said that they didn't know one other important detail, and that is that while CAICID was doing that, which was a group like the size of this, CAICID was also preparing for the Ninth World Assembly. And they were doing that without mentioning that to anyone else, but they were taking that on their shoulders even as they prepared for their first global forum. Now, that is a demonstration of a spirit of generosity par excellence. And so we thank you for this. We are honored by it. I continue just a couple of additional points. Our entire assembly moved as a formal motion of the assembly, and we have good hands in this assembly who are going to assist us that a letter will be written to His Majesty King Abdullah by the entire assembly in the name of the entire assembly to express our heartfelt appreciation for the global leadership that he is taking to advance friendly, neighborly, collaborative, affectionate relationships among all believers, and then, of course, his own patronage of our assembly. So we are honored to share this with you, that this letter is coming from the assembly. This same assembly also passed a resolution, a motion, and they've entrusted it to me. And just so you won't be surprised when you get it in the mail, I've been formally charged by this assembly to write you, good Secretary General of CAICID, to express the great goodwill and appreciation of this assembly to you at CAICID. We are going to go forward together, and we are already thinking of the ways in which the complementarity of our two organizations are mutually enhancing, and we love to use the word family to describe Religions for Peace, but that's a term that's expandable, and so we can think also of CAICID and Religions for Peace as having familial relations, so we will go forward in that way. Your Holiness, the Ecumenical Patriarch, I would, because we were so privileged to have you join us today, you wouldn't know, not having been here with us, that two bishops, very dear to your heart, one of them, your own brother, Orthodox Bishop, Archbishop Paul, and the Metropolitan Ibrahim, there is a call from this assembly, a call in love to those who hold the bishops, to please release the bishops. And so we will be issuing in ways that are respectful of human dignity that all have, that these brother bishops who are vital for the rebuilding of peace in Syria, who are precious in themselves. So, Your Holiness, I simply will share with you that the entire assembly is going forward, and this assembly turns to the Islamic members of this assembly with gratitude for the leadership that they have taken for the release of the bishops. And I note this as something that we have received, all of us, as an act of faithful love of our Islamic brothers and sisters. Finally, just a remark or two. We've had an assembly that has, first of all, tried to honor the distinctiveness of every one of our religions. We all have walked into this room, as we do in our daily lives, grateful to our own faith, and aware that each of our respective faiths has its own sublime vision of peace, gives the believers of that faith the actual taste of peace. And we've tried to describe that as positive peace, that peace is supremely positive. And that gives us hope even when there is, when in fact there are very grave threats to peace. It is, of course, incumbent on all of us, and we know this together, and we will do it shoulder to shoulder, to do all we can to build peace. And yet, our faiths teach us that we are not alone as we try to take this on. We are actually responding to the gift of peace, or the call of peace, that comes as our respective faiths offer it to us. So that gives us, each in our own way, but even collectively, that gives us great hope, a great and powerful hope that the work we do is not in vain, that the work we do, in fact, will bear fruit far beyond our efforts. And so we go forward from this assembly, strengthened by one another, heartened by the solidarity that we have, and yet summoned finally by the divine reality, or the ultimate reality, that is disclosed to us through our own very deep personal faith. So in a pledge of confidence with each other, we will now conclude the assembly in a way most fitting. We will have youth joining us here, and we will sing together as we did at the beginning of the assembly.
Looks so far, is me.
the new World Council will get to work. And so I'm simply recalling that the new World Council meeting is at 4:30 in the bank building. Please take a leisurely 7 minutes to get there. Okay, let's say, let's be there at 4:45 in the bank building.